Good morning. Good morning. I'm excited to be here this morning and share a message with you. And I come from a church called Cypress Springs Presbyterian Church in a pretty little town in Cameron, North Carolina, where we all talk with a British accent. So I'm going to share some scripture with you this morning and then get into our message. The scripture that I want to share with you comes from Jeremiah 29, verses 4 through 14. If you've got your Bibles, I welcome you to read it with me. You're welcome to listen or pull it up on your Palm Pilot, whatever you prefer. So thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters and multiply there and do not decrease. But seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its welfare you will find your welfare. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners who are among you deceive you, and do not listen to the dreams that they dream. For it is a lie that they are prophesying to you in my name, and I didn't send them, declares the Lord. For thus says the Lord, when 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will visit you, and I will fulfill my promise to you, and I will bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans of welfare, not for evil, but to give you a future and a hope. And then you will call upon me, and you will pray to me, and I will hear you, and you will seek me, and you will find me when you seek me with your whole heart. And I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes, and I will gather you from all the nations and all the places that I've driven you from, declares the Lord. And I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. The word of the Lord. Now, I just want to point out a couple of things in this scripture this morning, and I'm sure you picked up on it. How many times does the Lord say, I brought you? It was I that took you into exile. Thus says the Lord, I declare these things, not them, not King Nebuchadnezzar, not Belshazzar, nobody but the Lord. He says, I declare these things. I sent you here. And if I sent you there, then I'm going to bring you back. So in the present scripture that I just shared with you, and it's in the midst of the Babylonian captivity, we witness God's judgment against a sinful people, his people. Generations and generations of his people. And it's through his prophet Jeremiah that he's assuring his people that he was in complete control, that he is the supreme power, that he is the rule, authority, sovereign over all nations, and that one day they would be restored. And he assures them that there is hope. There's hope for you, and there's hope for the next generation, and the next generation, and the next generation. And what the Lord says, according to my promise, and according to my plan, not yours. It's according to my plan and my purpose. And I'm giving you a surety that I know exactly where you are, and I'm going to come, and I'm going to get you, and I'm going to bring you home. Now, for historical context, Jeremiah 29 is part of a letter that draws our attention to those who were in exile. These are God's chosen people. These are his people that he carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. They didn't carry themselves off into exile. He did. These are his people that the Lord scattered, that he separated throughout all of Babylon as a result of their sinfulness and their rebellion, and they're committing one horrid sin after the other. These are God's chosen people who had become so unfaithful and so shameful, transgressing over and over and over again, and living a lifestyle that was immoral and lawless and unjust, were expelled from their homeland. God's chosen people who had sinned so much that there seemed no remedy for these people. God's chosen people, his people, The people that he had compassion for, the people that he had a longing to save, a desire to protect, and a wanting to show mercy to, his chosen people, whom he loved so much and so fiercely and so intensely. These are people that he wanted, not needed. People, in spite of their unfaithfulness and his faithfulness, he determined that he was going to show them the unbreakable relationship between his justice and mercy, to show his people his righteousness and his faithfulness and his everlasting love and his covenant to his chosen people, generations and generations of his people who were not beyond saving. What a God, only God. You know, I know a person somewhat like these Israelites. I know someone who was rebellious and sinful and unfaithful, living a lifestyle that was immoral, one that was unjust, who had sinned so much that certainly there seemed no remedy. But praise be to God, he saved me, that I wasn't too far gone, that I wasn't too deep in sin, that I wasn't so unfaithful and so unrighteous that he didn't come after me. Just as we see here with the Israelites, they're not beyond hope. They're not beyond saving. Now, beginning here in chapter 25, Jeremiah, sent by God, following prophet after prophet, and warning after warning, and appeal after appeal, pleading with these folks to repent. We see here that Jeremiah delivered a letter that reminded them and us today that the Lord is the only one true living God, and there's no other God besides him, that he is sovereign, that he's active, that he does not change, and he alone rules. Praise be to God for a God that never changes. And Jeremiah was given this message to give to these folks because of their rebellious behavior, worshiping false gods and false prophets, much like the idols that we worship today, right? Right? Mm-hmm. And because of their rejection of God's laws and commandments that we don't reject today, right? Honestly. But because of that, because of the rejection, just like us, when we pick and we choose which ones we're going to adhere to. And it was because of their resistance to repeated warnings and messages, just like we turn a deaf ear to and a blind eye to, right? Because of their refusal to acknowledge the King of Kings, much like we do today when we sin in secret, right? Because of generations and generations of wicked behavior, they had aroused the anger of God and his judgment, and he was sending his people into exile. Generations of people. He called each and every one of them, his chosen people, he called into captivity. He did that. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles that I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. And God didn't drive his people in exile to forsake them. He didn't drive them there to abandon them. His purpose was not to destroy them, but he wanted to cleanse them and he wanted to purify them. And the God of Israel knew that in order for his people to turn away from their sinful behavior and their corrupt practices and back to him, they needed to see the consequence of their sin. Because of generations of rebellious behavior, the next generation suffered. And God wanted their surrender. And if you do not think that your behavior and your actions day in and day out, whether it's in the church or at home or at work or wherever you may be, if you do not think that your actions affect the next generation, then you are sadly mistaken. If you do not think that that next generation is watching everything you do and observing everything you do and listening to everything you say, then you are wrong. And this scripture is a reminder today to each and every one of us that they're watching and they're listening to everything we do and everything we don't do. Now, we applaud our children, right? When they mimic something, right? When they do something and we say, oh, he takes after you. Or she got that from her mom. You know, I have five children spanning two generations, as a matter of fact. We've got Gen Z and Alpha in my house. So we have a lot of generations. And we applaud them when they do something or they say something and we pat them on the back because, oh, they got that from me. And it's all fun and games until you're out in public or you're in church. And then they say something and you're like, he got that from you. That wasn't me. Oh, you get the, did you teach him that? No. So they're watching everything. They're listening to everything we say. And God, here in this scripture, he calls his people into a time of discipline, a correction, a time of submission, a time of yielding, a time out, if you like. You're familiar with timeouts? I think as a child growing up, that was the worst punishment, was being grounded. We call it grounded in England. I'm not sure if you say that in America, you do. So being grounded was the worst punishment in the world, not being able to go outside and play. And I remember my grandma would, I'd get grounded a lot actually. So I would get, grandma would ground me. And I would tell her, I'm sorry. Like, I'm just sorry. Can I go back outside and play now? I'm sorry. And she'd say, don't you tell me you're sorry if you don't know what you're sorry for. And I was like, okay. I get it now that I have children of my own. So, and nobody likes a timeout. But my grandma would not let me out of this grounding until I knew why I was there. It was a time where I was set apart. I was by myself. And she would come in every now and then and say, do you know what you're sorry for? No. And about an hour later, she'd ask me again, do you know what you're sorry for? Yes. And we would talk about it. And I was sorry. And I understood. And it was a time that brought me to her so that she could teach me and so that I was quiet enough and been in a place long enough where I was going to listen to her. Right? So we see here where God is doing exactly the same thing, and he's calling his people into this time of discipline and correction. And God promises the people that when they're truly broken before him, he would set them free. When they were truly broken, he would set them free. This was a time when their lives were changed forever. These folks had lost everything in exile, in captivity. Their homes, their property, their wealth, husbands and sons and wives and daughters. And they were being held captive in a foreign nation. Try and think how that feels for a second. I'm sure that they felt like their world had been turned upside down. I'm sure they felt overwhelmed and helpless, confused even. I'm pretty positive that their hearts were broken. I'm sure they were filled with worry and grief. I'm convinced they wanted to know, well, how could this happen? Have you ever asked that question? Well, how could this happen? How did it happen? And I bet these folks were drained. Y'all ever felt like that? And I bet they were weary. And I bet they were worn out. Y'all ever been in exile and felt like this? I bet they were beaten down physically and mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. But you see, God had to bring them down to do what he does and builds us right back up in him, as he does in each and every one of us. And they were undeniably experiencing life in exile. Y'all ever been there? Y'all ever been to that place called exile? It's not on the map. It's a heart condition. It's up here. I'm sure we've all experienced it. The people of Israel were called to surrender themselves to the Babylon captivity. I'm sure that was at the top of their list too. They're in exile, in captivity, and then they're told to surrender themselves to Babylon as they enter into exile, to examine themselves before God, to confess their sins, to repent, and to allow the King of Kings to reconcile them, to allow the King of Kings to restore them, to refine them through their suffering in exile. The hearts of these people would be made soft and they would be broken to the point that they would truly cry out to the Lord for deliverance. Have you ever been there? Do you remember that? God called his people into a time of reconciliation, a time of refinement under his sovereign control. He promised that he would restore the nation. He promised that he would bring his people back to the promised land. But it wouldn't be for 70 years. This exile would be long. This was a 70-year exile. But God said it's not permanent. And he purposed to humble his people, to bring them in before himself. And notice what he does, because God ain't going to take you somewhere and just leave you there and expect you to figure it out on your own, because that's not the God we serve, right? So he says to his people, I know you're tired. I know you're weary. I know you're in despair. And I know you feel defeated. I know you want things back to the way they once were. And I know you want to go home. But you're here, and you're going to be here for a while. So he gives them some instructions. In the midst of this exile, he said, settle down. Build houses. Plant gardens. Get married. Start families. Seek the welfare of the city. Unite, not divide. And don't give up. It's what he's teaching these generations that he's brought into exile. Now, I'm sure the top of their lists was to get married and to plant gardens and to build some houses. And I don't think so. But it was God's plan. And this is what he instructed them. He said, I know where you are because I brought you here. And while you're here, this is what I want you to do. He said, make the most of your circumstances. It doesn't matter how bad they are, because this was pretty bad for these exiles. Let's just be honest for a second. And God says, whatever your challenge and whatever your difficulty, whatever your adversity, whatever your misfortune that you encounter, stand strong before me, the Lord God. Be a witness to me through my power and my strength that I put in you, with the Holy Spirit that's been put inside you. Any circumstance that you're in, bear witness to me. Why? Because that next generation's watching. They're watching how you respond and how you react to that circumstance. Wondering, how's he going to deal with that one, I wonder? How's she going to get through that? You all ever experienced something like that? When you're in the midst of a trial or tribulation, a circumstance, your exile, and you know they're watching you. They're wondering, is she going to come through this one? Is he going to make it? You have a captive audience when you're in captivity. And the Israelites were told that they needed to do everything they could do to build the peace and the prosperity of Babylon so that they too could live in peace and prosperity. And although most of these parents and grandparents would die in Babylon, there was hope for their children and their children's children and their children's children's children. How we react today and how we behave today affects our children tomorrow. Did you all hear that? I'm going to say that again. How we react today, how you and I behave today in this moment affects our children. Tomorrow, they're watching everything we do and everything we say and how we react and how we deal with people and how we deal with the circumstances. They're watching what mom does. They're watching what dad does. They're watching what their pastor does. That next generation. And God promised to return his children to the promised land. He said, I will return you, and I will restore you, and I will reestablish and rebuild the whole nation of Israel. So don't lose heart. God understood their distress. He knew their sufferings. And he promised, after a time, I will bring you back. Now here it is, Hobby Lobby quote of the week. For I know the plans I have for you. Yep, say it if you know it. Declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a hope and a future. One of the most famously most quoted passages of the entire Bible. You can walk into any Hobby Lobby store across the United States of America, and I can guarantee you could get a plaque today, and you could put that anywhere you want in your house. But to know the context in which it was written, to know why the Lord told them this, I just shared this with you. Notice where this verse comes in this passage of Scripture. It doesn't come at the very beginning. It doesn't start with, "For I know the plans I have for you," declares the Lord, and then he talks about his folks in exile, and I want you to settle down and plant. And no, it doesn't come right there. It comes smack bang there in the middle. And he said, "For I know the plans I have for you." And it was in the midst of judgment, in the midst of exile, in the midst of captivity, that we see God assuring them of his promise. And he said, "I have called you by your name, and you're mine," right? Declares the Lord. The same God that called the Israelites into exile, the same God that called the Israelites into captivity, the very, very same God says, "For I know the plans I have for you, and they're not to destroy you. They're not to abandon you. I know it feels like it, but the plans I have are for hope and a future and to prosper, because I have called you by your name and you are mine. You belong to me." So, when that treatment isn't working the way it should, when the hurt isn't healing like we expect it to, and when the grief isn't fading like we want it to, and when the pain isn't going away, and our hope is weakening, and the faith is wavering, and the load isn't getting any lighter, and there's really no light at the end of the tunnel, it's there that God says, "For I know the plans I have for you," declares the Lord. And he goes on, he said, "And I will be found by you." God's never, ever lost. We are. We get lost all the time. And he said, "I will be found by you. And I will restore your fortunes. And I will gather you from all the places that I have driven you to," declares the Lord. "And I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. I will do this." You see, restoration is something that God desires to do in our lives. It was something he desired to do in the lives of the Israelites. It's something that he desires to do in each and every single one of us. It's about discovering and learning and stepping into the life that God has always intended for us to live. It's about allowing God to transform us from who we have been into who he wants us to be. Did y'all get that? Allowing him to transform us from who we have been into who he wants us to be. And notice in the scripture it said, "For I know the plans I have for you," declares the Lord. Not the plans Corrina has for Corrina. the plans that God has for Corrina, and thank God for that, because Corrina's plans were quite different to God's plans, very different. So thank God that he knows the plans he has for each and every one of us. And thank God that he does have a plan for a hope and a future, that he does want to restore us, that he does want to reconcile us, that he is the God of gods, that he is sovereign, and that he never, ever changes. Praise be to God. And here we see Jesus, who came to do exactly the same thing, to redeem and restore his people who are broken and lost and forgotten, torn apart, forsaken. You see, Jesus' desire is to work in you and through you, not by our power or our might or our strength, but by his power and his almighty strength of the Holy Spirit. He's transforming all of us into something new, into the person he wants us to be, that he has called each and every one of us to be, because he knows the plans that he has for each and every one of us. So it doesn't matter this morning. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't actually matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you have done. Because the scripture promises us that Jesus will redeem us. The scripture tells us that you are not too far gone. You are not beyond the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. And it's easy to feel like we've messed up, and it's easy to feel like we're irredeemable. We all got mistakes, right? And failures, and sins, and regrets. But praise be to God that the resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us a hope and power to believe that God is redeeming everything, even those tough situations, even those hard circumstances, even those things that you think are irredeemable, even those things that have got you to your wit's end, that you don't possibly see how any redemptive work can fix this. And Jesus said, but I can, because I know the plans that I have for you. His resurrection gives us hope. It gives us a power to believe that he is redeeming everything in us. And it's the power of your story is in the redemptive work that God has done in you. It's your story. It's your testimony. The redemptive work of Christ in you. And Jesus loves us, and he's committed to redeeming every and any aspect of our lives. So who you are and how you love and how you're serving others is something that every generation sees. I'm gonna say that one again. This is a freebie, I'm throwing it back in. Who you are and how you love, how you serve others, how you treat people, how you help people, what you do, what you don't do, is something that every generation sees. God is making his appeal to the world through you, through boomers and Gen X, millennials, Gen Z, Alpha. You are the mouthpiece for Jesus. You are the mouthpiece for sharing and proclaiming his redemptive heart. Well, worry about the next generation, that there may not be a next generation. Then speak up. Speak truth. Speak love. Serve others. Do what Christ commissioned us to do. In the words of the Apostle Paul, so we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. And we speak for Jesus when we plead, come back to God. I want to share one more thing with you before I pray. I have a lot of generations in my house, just in my kids alone, actually. And as I was preparing my message and working, my 15-year-old was doing his homework, which is a miracle in of itself, actually. So he was in the room with me doing his homework. So that's a praise report. He said something to me, and I said, Max, what are you talking about? And he, whatever this thing was, he said it again. And I told him, I said, son, I don't understand what you're talking about. And he said, Mom, he said, so you're preparing a message about the next generation and you don't speak our language. Woo! Yeah, that was powerful. Yet you don't speak our language. I was like, yeah, man, time out. So I wanted to share that with you because, I mean, we have this beautiful word of God. How many languages is this written in? How many translations do we have it in? And we don't need to change it. We don't need to change one word of this gospel, but we may need to put it into a language and speak the language of that next generation. Just like my son said, but Mama, you don't speak our language. So I'm going to pray for us, and we'll continue in the service with our praise hymn. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this time this morning, Lord, and we just acknowledge your presence here. We feel the power of your Spirit moving in and through us. Lord, we thank you for this message of hope, Heavenly Father, as it was hope for the Israelites, Heavenly Father, as they were in exile and captivity. Lord, it is hope for each and every one of us today, that there is hope today, and there's hope for the next generation. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would bless our children and our children's children, and that you would shine favor upon our children and our children's children and the generations to come. We praise your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen.